The following was made as a television videotape. Its purpose is to provide orientation for those teaching the CHEM Study course.
Chapter 8 of the CHEM Study materials discusses rates of reactions. It's common for us in teaching this to discuss rates of reaction in terms of molecular collisions, the orientation of the molecules upon collision, and the activation energy. What we want to do today is to look into these a little bit more deeply, do a few experiments, and see what insights we can get into the nature of the collisions, what we mean by orientation, and what we mean by activation energy. It seems quite clear that if two things are to react, they must collide. And therefore, the rate at which they react must depend on how often they collide. It also seems clear that when they collide, it may be possible for them to react if they collide with certain orientations and not with others. For example, if we take a match and a matchbox and strike the wrong end of the match, nothing happens. If we strike the right end of the match, it reacts. So an orientation term is normally required if one is completely to determine what goes on in a chemical reaction. And whether the match hits with this end or this end will certainly determine the rate of reaction. In the same way, we know that the temperature of a system affects the rate of reaction. And we interpret this temperature effect in terms of what we have come to call the activation energy. Now let's do some experiments to try to shed some real insight, some deeper insight, into the nature and the behavior and the variation in these three variables, and perhaps see if there are any other variables which are important. What about collisions? One might guess that when two things react, or when three things react, or when four things react, the rate of reaction would depend on the concentration of everything involved in the reaction. Well, the system we're going to discuss now consists of water, in which has been dissolved some sodium hydroxide. The actual concentrations are 20 grams of sodium hydroxide in a liter of water, 20 grams of dextrose or glucose in the same liter, and some 1% methylene blue solution. You notice that the solution now appears just like water. But if we shake it, a change occurs. The solution darkens. A reaction has occurred which leads to the formation of a blue color. If we shake a little longer, the blue color is more obvious. Not only is it more obvious, it lasts considerably longer. However, even now, it eventually clears up. Now suppose we shake quite a bit longer. We get the same intensity of the color as we did the second time. No more blue color has been formed. But notice that the depth of the color is maintaining itself over a longer period of time. It hasn't yet started to fade. Why is this? What is going on in the bottle? And why is it that the rate of reaction, or apparent rate of reaction, seems to change? We can study this in many ways. Perhaps, for example, when I shake the bottle, I'm shaking the liquid up on the stopper. Well, if I upend it, no color change occurs. And therefore, whatever is causing this color change, it doesn't have to do just with shaking or with contact with the top of the bottle. Perhaps you might think that when I shake it, I heat the solution, and it changes color when I heat it, and then as I let it stand, it loses heat, cools off, and goes back to colorless. We can test this hypothesis merely by warming the bottle. I'll warm it with my hands many times more than I warmed it when I shook it. And yet, as you see, there is no color change. Further testing would show that what is actually happening is the gas in the top of the bottle is being used up. If I pull out the stopper here, one can see gas go into the bottle. Gas is being used up. And therefore, the reaction here is between the gas in the top of the bottle and the liquid. When I shake, I mix the gas and the liquid. Then a reaction occurs which uses up the dissolved gas. The length of time the material stays blue depends on how long I shake, and hence on how long the molecules are in contact. But notice what really happens. The more I shake, the more material I dissolve. And you might suspect that since its concentration is going up, it would disappear more rapidly. This is not true. If I shake once, the color may last perhaps 10 seconds. If I shake twice carefully and measure the color time, it may be 20 seconds. Three times, 30 seconds. In other words, the length of time the bottle stays colored is directly related to the amount of oxygen, because that is the gas which is in here, which is dissolved in the solution. Now, this is very unusual. We have put more oxygen in the solution each time by continued shaking. And yet the time it takes that oxygen to disappear does not depend on the concentration of the oxygen, in the sense that even though there are more collisions, the rate proceeds at the same old number. A certain amount of oxygen disappears in 10 seconds, twice as much oxygen disappears in twice as long, three times as much oxygen disappears in three times as long a time. Why is this? The answer is that in this particular case, there is a complicated mechanism going on. The oxygen dissolves and dissolves quite rapidly and forms the blue material. But now the blue material reacts only slowly with the glucose which is in the solution. This slow reaction occurs to produce oxidation products of glucose and regenerates the colorless form of the methylene blue. This now can react with the oxygen that is left over. And the slow step is what determines the overall rate. Let's write this down here on the board so that we can see it more clearly. Oxygen initially reacts with the methylene blue, which we'll call MEBL, to give the blue material. The blue material, let me move over to the other side here, now reacts with glucose to give colorless methylene blue plus products. The methylene blue produced here now goes back and reacts with some more of the dissolved oxygen to give this. This is a fast step. This is a slow step. The rate of the slow step is determined by the concentration of glucose and the concentration of the blue material. But the concentration of the blue material is limited by how much methylene blue we put in. We didn't put in very much, and therefore there cannot be very much of this present. As fast, however, as this slow step does occur, as fast as the blue material reacts with the glucose to give this, this in turn reacts with some more oxygen to give further blue material, which then reacts with glucose to give some more of this. Now, what does all this have to say about collisions? Well, we see in order for this reaction to occur, we must have a collision between this and this. But this reaction will occur almost every time there is a collision, because it is a fast reaction. The second reaction also requires a collision between the blue material and the glucose, but this is a slow reaction. It only occurs in a small fraction of the collisions. When it does occur, you get the products and the colorless form of methylene blue, which can then go back and remove some more of the dissolved oxygen. The system will then stay blue as long as there is dissolved oxygen to be removed. And the length of time the system will stay blue depends on how much oxygen one dissolves. If you dissolve a certain amount of oxygen, let's say 1 unit, it takes 10 seconds for the reaction to occur because the slow step determines it. If we dissolve twice as much oxygen, since methylene blue is a limiting reagent, we produce the same concentration of blue material. Therefore, this reaction proceeds at the same rate, the same slow rate, and it takes twice as long to remove the oxygen. Here we have an example, then, which is very typical of chemical reactions, where the overall rate is determined by the slowest step. The fast step that precedes it will occur whenever it can, whenever the ingredients are present. But the slow step can occur only when the molecules collide with the proper orientation and when they collide with activation energy. Now let's look at this term about activation energy for just a moment. What do we mean by this? Here's another experiment that you might like to do in your own classrooms. We all like to blow up balloons. This particular balloon is blown up with about half hydrogen and half air. If we're going to do experiments with hydrogen and oxygen, we know they're dangerous. It pays to put on safety glasses. In fact, whenever you do an experiment in the chemistry laboratory, one should wear safety glasses. If I had my way, every student in a chemistry lab would wear safety glasses. And I would strongly suggest that in your own courses, you insist that your students do indeed wear safety glasses whenever they are in the laboratory. We'll now experiment with this hydrogen and oxygen. Well, now, hydrogen and oxygen are very reactive materials with respect to one another. And in this balloon, we are having continual collisions between the gaseous hydrogen and the gaseous oxygen. Why doesn't the reaction proceed at a very fast rate? In fact, why doesn't it blow up? One can interpret this in many ways. Certainly, within the balloon, many collisions are going on. And of all those collisions, there certainly must be some with a favorable orientation to cause reaction and to give water, the final product. We know that if we heat this, the reaction rate will go up. And therefore, what we have called activation energy here must be related in some way to the temperature. In what way? If we supply energy to this, what happens? The molecules are banging around at room temperature right now. If we raise the temperature, each time they will collide with greater vigor. Therefore, it is easier for the molecules, which are currently H2 molecules and O2 molecules, but which will react to give water, it is easier for the molecules here at least to consider the likelihood that they should rearrange their atoms. After all, we must break the hydrogen-hydrogen bond here to form the water, and we must break the oxygen-oxygen bond. These bond-breaking reactions will require energy. On the other hand, we will form water, and these bond-forming reactions will generate energy. Perhaps if we give a little bit of energy to the system, we can increase the rate of the forward reaction. Well, let's try. Having put on our safety glasses, we can light a long-handled taper here, because if there is going to be a rapid reaction, we just as soon not have our hand too close. We'll now supply. Well, that was a fairly fast reaction. We didn't supply much energy, just a little bit, but enough, apparently, so that the hydrogen and oxygen collided, because they were hot, more vigorously than at room temperature. Once they started to collide, they began to form water. This process is exothermic, and the heat of reaction then can go back into providing more energy, which loosens up these bonds. Now, this raises the question whether it is necessary completely to break these molecules apart in order for them to form water. Must the hydrogen be dissociated into hydrogen atoms? Must the oxygen be dissociated into oxygen atoms? Or can they rather collide as molecules and then form water in this intermediate stage? The answer to this question varies from reaction to reaction. In some reaction, the initial molecules must actually disintegrate into their component atoms. But this requires a lot of energy. The activation energy for such reactions requiring complete dissociation would be very high indeed. The activation energy would be much less if, when these molecules collide, they could collide with such an orientation that the bonds here could slowly weaken as the bonds here formed. If this were true, the activation energy could be considerably less than the energy necessary to break these molecules apart. In the particular case of the reaction hydrogen plus oxygen to give water, we have a very complicated mechanism which has been studied by thousands of chemists for many years. In fact, there are still features of this reaction that are not understood. It is, however, rather well established that in this particular case, the activation energy primarily goes into dissociating this molecule. The molecule really has to come apart before the next step can occur. The products then, the hydrogen atoms, go on and react with oxygen molecules to give strange intermediates, strange to a chemist working in a normal classroom, like HO2, HO, and other highly reactive intermediate species. These intermediate species then continue through their normally bimolecular collisions, two molecules coming together with an appropriate orientation and sufficient additional energy of activation, eventually to give water. We then see that collisions are indeed necessary, and that the orientation must be proper for the reaction, and that for each of these simple steps in the mechanism, although the overall mechanism may be quite complicated, The simple steps are usually involving two molecules, like hydrogen atom plus an oxygen molecule gives HO2. The simple steps involve two molecules which must collide with the proper orientation and with appropriate activation energy. The activation energy is normally represented in terms of going over a potential hill, like this. Here are the initial reactants with fairly low energy. Here are the products with a different energy, maybe higher, maybe lower. In order to get from here to here, more energy, more potential energy must be added. And this distance is the activation energy. Along this coordinate, we have plotted what is called the reaction coordinate. This is a very complicated algebraic function, which we need not concern ourselves with. For our purposes, we can treat this as a measure of the orientation of the molecule and the distance apart of the atoms. If we then plot this complicated function, whose exact nature doesn't concern us, against the potential energy here, we find that for typical actual reactions, we get a curve of this nature. Remember, this is the energy, the potential energy of the reactants. This is the potential energy of the products. The difference in energy between this part of the curve and the top is the activation energy, the energy necessary for a reaction to occur. Let's now look at one of the CHEM study films on kinetics of chemical reactions to see some mechanisms in which potential energy is plotted against reaction coordinates.